the Madisonville Library District Board of Trustees to order. It is 7:00 PM on Wednesday, October 19th, 2016. Diane, please take the roll.
Here.
Karen is ready. Carolyn?
Here.
Barbara?
Here.
Patty?
Here.
Linda?
Here.
And Tim gave previous speech.
Please take, stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Welcome, everyone. Go Cubs! I think we have another 5 minutes, so I can start. Okay, the first item on the agenda is the approval of the minutes of the regular board meeting of September 21st, 2016. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Barb? And Patty? Do we have any amendments? Okay, Diane, please take the roll.
Rob?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
All right, is anybody registered for public comments? Okay. All right. Then the next item on the agenda is the treasurer's report. Greg?
Okay, for the month of September, revenue was short of budget expectations by $62,000. And we're ahead of budget expectations by $324,000 for the year. And the variances are due to real estate collection rates, real estate tax collection rates. Salaries for the month are $10,000 in excess of budget estimates, or 3.7%. That's because September was a five-week pay month. If you remember, we have, I believe, four of those during the year, and then the rest are four-weekers.
So then it'll be that?
Yeah. But we're still short of budget estimates, but we see almost $63,000, or 7.8% of the year. Library materials, a little over budget by 13%, or $8,000. We're $31,853 over budget, or 17.2% of the year. And as in past years, it's due primarily to the payment of annual subscriptions, which are basically 1 year in advance, and then they work themselves out for the next 12 months. Library operating expenses, $11,000 in the budget, 34.5% for the month, and $29,000, or 30% year-to-date. And this is primarily due to slow spending in the software for capital items. General administrative expenses, $13,000 in the budget, 54% for the month, $25,000, or 34.4% year-to-date. And that's due to slow spending in the consultant item primarily. Employee fringe benefits are $7,317 in the budget, or approximately 10% for the month, $16,316, or 7.4% year-to-date. These numbers reflect charges from IMRF for the month, totally $19,363. And utilities are within $1,000, both monthly and year-to-date. For the month, the net deficit is $465,962, which is $26,531, unfavorable to the budgeted net deficit of $439,430. And $522,485, favorable year-to-date. If you have any questions, be happy to take them.
Thank you. I will now entertain a motion to approve the payment of bills for operating expenses of $229,830.24. Payroll expenses of $273,979.84. Special reserve expenses of $0, for a total monthly expense of $503,810.08.
So moved.
Second, Barb and Patty? Any discussion? Okay, Diane, please take the roll.
Rob?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Okay, next item on the agenda is the director's report.
Okay. I just wanted to pass out a little picture of you all that Natasha got into the, I forget which one, journal, I think.
I think it's Vans.
Vans, Harold. Harold, Harold Spectator? Okay. Anyway, that's a picture of you all with your food for fines last month. Not always pretty cute. I wanted to let you know that the majority of the trustees, in fact, all of you, said that November 9th was going to be a good date for your focus session. So your focus session with the strategic planning consultants will be November 9th, which is another Wednesday. So.
What time?
7:15. We have another thing sandwiched ahead of it. We also are going to be able to have a focus group, a large focus group, one of the sort of more town hall meeting type things up at D Park, thanks to John Jacket. He's letting us use one of their rooms to have people up at the north end of the district. So I think that's great, it's up in unincorporated displays, and so we'll be able to get some of the people that have a harder time getting down here. So one of the groups will be physically located up there. We have been proceeding with the possibility of becoming a passport agency, and we have actually had Tiffany Nash out, our former, our architect from the last renovation, to help us look at where to put a passport desk and where, and how to design it, because we don't have an existing desk that is the right height. All of our desks are kind of tall, and you need to have a desk where it would be handicap accessible. So she is developing plans for that.
Would you take getting pictures taken or two, or would you like to bring?
No, we're not going to try to handle the picture taking part, because that's available at so many other places.
Like Walton.
Yeah, exactly. So we'll have a list of all the places you can go, but we won't actually try to do the pictures ourselves. So that is moving along. And then, you remember last time, Tim Spadoni and I had attended a parliamentary workshop, and we promised you guys the handout from that, so that is what this is. I'm not going to go through it page by page, but if you go through it and you find anything that strikes you about the way we are going about things or anything that you found interesting, please let me know and we can put it back on the agenda and talk about it next month. Let's see, I just wanted to remind you that Sasha has been, had that great idea of doing the Library President for a Day program, which is getting a lot of attention. I just got an email from another library director, the director of Naperville the other day, asking if she could, if they could steal that idea, because they really liked it. So the winner, the child winner of that program will be at your board meeting next month, and that will be another photo op, so just so you know.
Yes,
and, but they'll be getting a key to the library.
I want a key to the library.
Well, you don't qualify, I'm sorry.
That was kindergarten through what grade?
Sorry, I didn't write that down.
I saw it in your thing, K through eight, that's what it could be, which I think is pretty cool.
It's really cute.
It's neat that it's with the local younger ones too.
Yes, and that he worked with Ariane to come up with, I think, child appropriate prizes, so that it's not getting, you know, a gift card or something like that. It's that they get to pick the books for a book display, and they get to pick the movie, get a family movie one week, and they get special seating at one of the second Sunday specials, and so. Yes, so that'll be fun. But the biggest thing will be their photo op with you guys. So looking forward to that. And then the other thing on the agenda next month for something completely different is the audit. So next month will be a busy meeting, and that is all I have.
I have a question.
Yes,
regarding the passports that we're going to be providing, or are we providing the application process? What?
We would become a passport agency. Okay. Which we have to work with the Passport Agency of Chicago, which is part of the State Department.
Okay, so can we take the time to determine what in fact it's going to involve in terms of staff to provide this service? To see what it will cost us? I understand we'll be making $25 per passport.
Correct.
And what will it cost us to provide the service?
Well, I mean, that's what I really am not going to know, because I'm not going to know how many people are going to show up at the door. We're going to have to staff according to that. But I don't have a estimate on the desk yet. I don't have any of that mapped out yet.
Do you know what the process is to provide the service?
I know.
What does it mean in terms of employees, and what will they need to do? That's one way to engage in it. And what pay level do you think needs to be staffed?
Well, I have started working on all of that, but I don't have it firmly ironed out. My intention is to pull staff from a variety of levels from throughout the library, but there's no question that we will need to increase our staffing somewhat, because my understanding is that the busy time of year for passports is January, February, March, which is right about when we think we'll probably be getting it started.
And that's fine. I'm asking, before you accept this, that you already know what it will cost you to man this project?
I will only have an estimate.
Why?
How would I know how many people are gonna show up?
It's not how many people. If only one person comes, what does assisting one person for a passport entail? What type of record keeping needs to be done?
Right, right. Well, yeah, I mean, I'll have all of that. That's the easy part, though, that the hard part is having a physical body at a desk to be able to help people and sorting a process out that makes sense. And the State Department will want to inspect where we're keeping our forms and all of our procedures before we get started.
Right.
So we're not, anyway, I have applied for this, but I have not gotten to the point where I've called the State Department back and said, you know, I'm gonna have X number of employees working on this. And so, you know, this is all still planning, so, you know, I've not committed anything with Tiffany yet on the desk, but I have to know how much the desk is gonna cost before I go on.
Well, what I'm, can I just finish? What I'm asking is, before we even go any further, can you determine out of your staff, who do you think will be handling this process? What will that cost us? How many hours do you think they'll be at this desk? Just estimate it. Are you gonna pull them randomly before we even accept it? Because it seems like we don't prepare to accept things. We jump in, then all of a sudden we have an expense and we have to figure out how to offset it. I mean, we should be able to determine, based on other people who do this, how they determine the cost to provide this service. Because we don't want to be providing a service we can't afford.
Oh, absolutely. Right.
So I'm asking that you do all this legwork. If you need help doing that, if you need someone to guide you.
I think
you know,
kind of what you're asking, and you can, you know, tell me if I'm wrong. I think what I would like to know, maybe would kind of justify or help that, would be for each passport, how long does it take from beginning to end? Like if somebody came in and said they need a passport, does it take 10 minutes? Does it take 15 minutes? It might matter, is it a brand new one or is it one that they actually need to renew? So based on that, and then maybe talking to Skokie or somebody else, how many they have, maybe.
Skokie isn't doing it yet.
We went up to Puebla and talked to them,
and we got all of the information about how they go about theirs and the process of it. And, you know, sometimes it's 5 minutes if you're really lucky, but you know, sometimes it's a family of four, and it's a much more complicated thing.
Might be a different language.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So it's going to be variable.
Then once the 10-minute interaction is over, what more do we need to do to facilitate the requirements of the state?
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, you have to send it off that night, so you have to have your hours set up to finish all of that.
This all needs to be calculated. It's just like anything else
you
do.
Well, I mean, I can figure out how many hours I'm going to need on that desk. That I can do.
Right. Based on what they're going to do. Rather than say 3 hours, I'd like to know for 3 hours they've got to interact with the customer. They have to fill out some state forms. They have to send something over the internet. They have to make copies. I mean, you need to have a job description.
I actually have prepared a job description for
which
the person that I think will be running the program, but the other people are going to be existing members of the staff. So it's going to be not going to be a job description so much as the tasks that the person at that desk is going to need
to
be able to do.
So we need somebody to run the program, and we need people to facilitate the needs of the customers. That's quite a bit of staffing to provide a passport.
Well, right, it is. But when I talked with the board about this before, you all were very positive about it, which is why I have continued to pursue it.
Okay, it's a great idea, but we're getting $25 per passport. It can't cost us $300 to process one passport with all these salaries. That's what we need to think of.
I guess another question, too, is how many hours, like, do we have to have a minimum of how many hours we actually are open?
I just renewed my passport across the street, and I found out that they have limited hours for service.
That's what I was just thinking.
I don't
thinking,
think they
right?
can renew or get a, they don't have passport service before 2 o'clock in the afternoon.
Right.
Because they're really busy with post office work.
Right.
So if we had hours in the morning from, say, 9 to 12, all those people who would want to go in the morning would come over here. So we might have limited hours, say, 9 to 12, and try it out, see how it works.
Right, or do we have to have so many hours? I guess that's my question. Do we have to be open 12 hours a week minimum?
No,
But they do want, they want any new passport agencies to be offering passports during their open hours. So you, you wouldn't have to do it like from the very moment you open to the very moment the doors close, because that wouldn't be practical. So what I had been thinking was it would be starting at, you know, maybe 9:30 and ending, sort of like we do the summer reading desk, where, you know, it starts a little after the library opens and it closes a little bit before the library closes, so that staff have time to deal with that.
Or does it even have to be open at the same time the office is opening across the street? Maybe that doesn't make sense.
Well, I mean, that's their regulation, was that you had to do it when you're, during your open hours.
But even the post office doesn't provide a service during all
of
the...
Well, many of the post offices are cutting back on their hours. They actually, that's why they are going to the libraries.
She's bringing up a really good point.
You know what I'm saying?
If the post office across the street, she's saying, offers 8 to 12, we should offer hours differently.
They have like 2 to 4.
But I'm telling you that the State Department, to okay a new, to approve a new agency, wants you to do it during the hours you're open. They don't want you to restrict your hours.
Does it say how many, does it? How many hours? Does it say how many?
No, it's your open hours.
All your open hours?
Well, that's what she's saying, you can maybe start a little bit after you open and stop a little bit before you close.
We can't be responsible to have employees here randomly for 7 hours.
You know, it's not gonna be that big a deal. Once you do one, it's gonna be so easy.
So you basically, you just have to have...
Once you do a few, you could do it the line number.
One person per shift that knows how to do it, just like you have one person who does that.
And then when needed, they walk over and they take care of the person.
Notary, you know, that's kind of here most of the time.
Right, right, we have several people trying to...
You just have to see.
There'll be times when there's lines on the door waiting, and there'll be times when there's nobody waiting, but I think we're gonna come out ahead.
If we end up finding that it really becomes too cumbersome, and then it really becomes costing us too much, can you back out?
Yeah, you can, I mean, it, but a certain amount of expense will have been sunk into it.
Yeah,
and
then just, you know, just blown it up.
Yeah.
And well, then I just had one thought about this desk you have to purchase. Did you say some kind of desk that someone's going to check? What is the post office? Do you just walk up to the counter?
Right.
Right, they do, but I mean, that's not handicap accessible.
Sure it is.
Well, they're, yeah.
It just has to be 3 inches off the ground.
Okay, but I don't have that here, except at circulation, that's the only, well, and children's services, and I'm not going to put it at children's services.
No, I'm just saying.
Oh, I see.
No, I have gone further with all this. I had not planned on getting into this tonight. I do have considerably more plans, but I don't have them written out for you, and I don't have estimates. So, you know, why don't we talk about this again next month when I've done a little bit.
We've got a lot of good ideas.
Okay, sounds great.
I have one other question.
I think it's great for the community, and I think it's a great service.
I think it would be, yeah.
About the strategic planning?
Yes.
Focus groups and what's the forum? Are those scheduled yet, or is the purpose of them determined?
They're on the, they're on November 9th and 10th. We just have ironed out the schedule today, as a matter of fact, this afternoon. They're gonna be, the contract that you guys signed with the consultants is for 12 of them total, so that's what we're gonna do. Two of them are the big groups, one of them up at D Park and one of them down here on two different times. One of them is you guys and me, one of them is the supervisors and managers, two staff, and then we have figured out we want to talk to business people, we want to talk to educators, we want to talk to community leaders, so that's three more of the groups.
And it all takes place on
these 2 days, yeah, it's gonna be jam-packed.
Could we see a list of who's meeting when or what the groups are calling when they're meeting?
Well, I mean, we literally did this afternoon. So,
but I'm just saying, when can we see what it is? I know it's going to be posted.
Well, it won't be before the next board meeting. I mean, the next board meeting is after this.
We're not doing this until January, correct?
You know, the retreat is in January.
Okay,
focus groups are November 9th and
10th. Okay.
Yeah, the one we're supposed to be at, she said, is in the evening on the 9th.
So how soon can I find out what the schedule is? Before November 9th, I hope, right? Can you email us?
Yeah, well, I definitely will be emailing you the times to ask people to come. But we're going to be signing people up for different groups based on the mosaic data of the different slices of population that they gave us, so that we'll be mailing letters to people that are not library card users and trying to get them to come. So that's going to be a big group that we're trying to get. And then we also are reaching out to you guys. I mean, if you have people you want invited, you certainly can let us know and we will send invitations to them.
Okay, once we figure out what the groups are for and what the purpose is, then we'll know who to recommend, right?
Right, who's like within the groups, like the demographics of the group.
Right. Oh, that'd be great. Okay, good. I look forward to that. Thank you.
Okay.
Are we still talking about your stuff?
Yes.
Okay, I just have one quick thing to say. People at West know I'm on the board here, and I get more and more people coming up to me and telling me they're not library card holders in Niles, but telling me how wonderful Niles is, and they wish their libraries were like ours.
That's nice to hear. Thank you. And the Maker Fest at the November 12th?
Yes.
What time does that start?
1 to 4.
One to four.
Yeah, Suzie's in charge of that. We have a lot of great people coming.
Great.
It's gonna be spectacular.
What is that? What is that?
Maker Fest, it's gonna be, Suzie, why don't you talk about it?
So it's going, so last year we did Smashbox to kind of kick off all of the digital equipment and launch the spaces, and this year we're kind of focusing on what people have done and what you can do. So it'll be kind of half activities that people can engage in the studio, and then we went out and got local makers and local artisans from the community to kind of come and share with people, you know, either a hands-on activity, or we have someone doing needlecraft, we have a quilter, we have BotSpot, which is a robotics business in Niles. They're gonna come and show robots, and Home Depot's coming, Art Station, some artisans that we've kind of just went and got. So it's gonna be kind of a celebration of making and engineering and crafts. So it should be a lot of fun. On your way out, if you look by the display case, and on the first floor, the glass one, we have a bunch of some quilts and mosaics. The art teacher at Culver is going to be doing a collaborative mosaic project, and then we'll get to keep that. So yeah, it should be a lot of fun.
So this is what time did you say?
1 to 4.
1 to 4.
All ages.
All ages, yeah.
And this wonderful. And that's what day of the week?
Saturday.
And then the only other thing that I had a question for was when you had gone about the Roberts Rules.
Yes.
The interest, okay, whoever makes a motion cannot speak against it.
Yes, and the Roberts Rules.
Okay, so.
Excuse me, what did you just say?
Whoever makes the motion cannot speak against it.
Excuse
me, it would kind of say, right, because usually you do kind of like, you know, if you're for it, you're for it, right?
Well, sometimes people want to get something on the table.
They won't do that anymore.
So, is it the person that makes the motion and seconds the motion? That's my question.
No, just the motion.
Just the motion. So it's not the person who makes the second.
No.
Okay, that was my question.
Yeah.
Okay. Just to clarify. Anything else?
Nope, that's it.
Okay.
Communications, you've got the suggestions and comments, and which are almost all positive this one. It's something you want to be able to answer. And then just a couple of nice emails. There's one email and then a card from the Jewish Senior Life that come out here and do counseling with people, one-on-one. So thanking our business librarian, Judy.
And Barbara, Buildings and Grounds.
Let me pass out these draft minutes from our Building and Grounds Committee meeting. Heads up.
Oh, sorry. Oh, thank you.
Product architecture to design the exterior signage for the building. So, do you know how long they're gonna, how long it would be before they get back to us?
Well, no, you have it as a motion on tonight's agenda.
Okay.
So,
all right.
So that's our recommendation.
That's our recommendation.
Okay. And then secondly, We talked about some renovations in the washrooms, which you can read about in these draft minutes.
And we did a tour too?
Yes, we did a tour too.
Of all the bathrooms.
I was excited.
Excited.
And I missed that.
No, and I missed that.
Mr. Chance.
I'm sorry.
Okay, technology. Let's see, next I have the liaison reports, Friends of Library, Carolyn.
Oh, there wasn't a meeting this month, so nothing to report. Oh, I have a question though. Do we have the information for the cost to process donated books?
No.
I don't know that at this time. You know, when we might be able to.
You know what, I don't, I'm going to talk with you guys about that at another time because the whole situation is complicated. I never intended the board to review our procedures. That's kind of an in-house business. It's really, the thing I was trying to point out to the board is that the Friends of the Library were not the ones doing this work. So that point has already been made. And then our behind-the-scenes procedures, I think, you know, we'll continue to work on. And Cindy could do a whole presentation on all of the steps that go into all the things that the volunteers do, but I just don't know how productive that would be.
Now, I'm not looking for a presentation. You mentioned it was very costly for the library, and I asked how is it that we go about it that it's so expensive.
Well, and so I did outline in the last board packet the steps of going through the donation process.
So what is the cost to us to do that? That it's so costly?
I didn't say that it was costly. I said it's all being done by staff.
No, but you said it was very costly, and that's why I had decided we should bring it to Friends. So if it's, and you said that you needed different levels of people to handle that,
right?
And that's a little kind of, it's actually questionable that we would need high salary people.
Okay, well, I'll have a presentation next month then, and Cindy can go ahead and tell you guys exactly how it goes about, because she has it really very streamlined at this point, and you'll just be able to see what they're doing.
And we'll be able to figure out what it costs to process these. It's no longer costly then?
I think it would be.
Well, I guess it depends on the time.
Yeah, it costs, but my main point. Sure, it is, yeah.
Well, I don't want you to put together a presentation unless, like, everybody wants to know that. So I don't want to, so I mean, do we really need a presentation on?
No.
Yeah, I don't think so.
The way I understood, because I remember this discussion from last month, the way I understood it was that it is mostly being done by volunteers and some staff.
Correct.
That yes, there was some expense, but I don't remember you saying costly. I remember some expense because some of it is being done by staff. At this time, there weren't really, like at some places they might have, the Friends are actually running the whole show.
Right.
Here it is.
That's correct.
That's the way I understood it.
Right. So what is the Friends role and what do we want the Friends role to be?
Exactly.
I can understand that.
That I can understand.
The question.
And ask them, are they willing to step up and take more of a role in that position, in that situation?
Carolyn, maybe at your next Friends meeting, you can ask for volunteers and see if they want to take over some of that work.
Well, actually, at our last Friends meeting, we mentioned that it was costly for the library and that Susan was going to provide them with the information. And President Hanusiak mentioned that he would be willing to help assist the library in this process.
How so?
So, well, we haven't gotten any work. She wasn't prepared at that meeting. So at our next meeting, we can certainly take it a bit further.
I don't know what you're looking for from Susan.
Exactly what she was going to provide. What it cost for us to process books. Because it got to the point where we decided maybe we didn't want to do that. Remember all that conversation?
Well, that's kind of ridiculous. That's a service to the community.
Well, that's exactly what Karen Diamond said. But what I'm saying is, you know, it came up. I mean, to say it only costs us $50 a week to process, you know, donated books. I mean, I don't see why it's so difficult to be able to understand how a particular position is used. and understand why it's so complicated.
What I agreed to do, and I still am planning to do, but I don't have the figures yet, is give you guys an accounting for how much staff time is going into it.
Makes sense.
But it's technical services that's been doing most of the handling of it, and they have been recording how much time it's taking, but they haven't been doing it for long enough to really show the picture.
That's probably all we need to do, just tell us how much time is, I think that would, and that would constitute, like, okay, an average hourly salary, you'd be able to figure that out within, you know, 10 minutes.
No, we can definitely work up that information.
Yeah, that's easy, that's all we need.
So we're not concerned that we have high salary people handling this?
I don't think so.
Because we did make that comment too, that you needed someone to oversee this process.
I have someone who oversees all of the volunteers, she had her volunteer recognition luncheon this last, or event this last Sunday. And how many volunteers? 62, was it?
We have 68 adult volunteers, 8 of them work in the bookstore, if I could just make a comment.
Please do.
So it's a difference really of quality, because if the staff are involved, there's a little bit more screening on the material, and so what actually ends up in the sale is a little higher quality, because you don't get CDs that won't play, or DVDs that won't play. So the staff takes pride in making sure that the things that they put on the sale rack are going to be worth the money the patrons pay. So we don't get a lot of returns, because that was a problem in the past. So if we have volunteers just screening the material, some of them aren't really comfortable with, you know, what is a good CD, what is a good DVD. So having the staff at least look at some of the material and be concerned about the quality of the material that goes in the sale actually is a service to the patrons as well. So that is some of the work that the staff is doing, is sort of screening some of the material.
And Cindy, the volunteers, so there are how many of them?
So there are 8 specifically that work in the sale room, and they work 1 to 2 hours a week.
Okay. Now those are not necessarily friends of the library. There are people who just volunteer directly for the library.
Yes, they are. We have asked the friends to sort of bring them into the fold, sort of, and said they are invited to their annual luncheon now because they are working in the book sale, but they came in through the library, okay. Volunteers, yeah.
So the staff that goes, time that goes into it is almost entirely clerical, and then Cindy in helping get this basic procedures set up and giving them some guidance.
You just do because they're not high paid doesn't mean your time isn't valuable.
Well, absolutely.
Right.
Go ahead. Well, I remember, and I might not be remembering this correctly. You weren't taking a loss, right?
No.
So that's the big thing. We aren't taking a loss for this. We are getting money out of this. So technically, it's balancing itself out.
Right. And again, we're not a profit organization.
Yes, but the way I just want to verify if we're not taking a loss.
Go ahead.
Well, I just wanted to mention one thing, that many volunteers are uncomfortable handling the money. So the fact that the money is not part of the book sale and the volunteers, I think, helps us retain the volunteers, because they like working with the materials, but they don't want to be responsible for, you know, the sales and taking the money and all of that.
Which is understandable.
Makes sense.
All right,
well, thank you. I appreciate that.
Thank you.
Okay, legislative.
Susan.
Okay, Andrea. All right, secretary's report. The new business. I have a motion from the Building and Grounds Committee to approve the proposal for designing exterior signage for Product Architecture. Since this is a motion from committee, we don't need a second motion. So, take a roll motion. Oh, so because they already made the motion, so I don't need a second motion. Okay, I'll get it.
Any discussion?
Can we just see the, or just go?
I can explain it.
Oh, right here.
Isn't that this one?
I don't understand what it means.
October 19th.
Did someone explain it?
Oh, God. Okay.
Oh, why, you can't take 5 minutes just to explain what we're having built? No, I don't want you to read the minutes, I'm wondering what are we?
Oh, right there, this one?
This?
No, it's page 32 of your packet.
Page 32, I thought it was 31.
Got it.
So this is the proposal from Product Architecture, and the Building and Grounds Committee looked at a second proposal. This is all a new memo. from the Lakota group, which was twice the cost, and included fewer things, so. And Product Architecture was our architects on the last renovation, so they would be doing signage that matched the style of the building.
That was my question, just that it was, okay, so it matches the style. I know that's what we were looking at, rather than matching the village, we want to match what we have already, which makes sense.
Well, just to clarify, Lakota group wasn't gonna match the village, they would have.
Oh, they would have designed our own.
Oh, okay. But their cost was so much higher that.
I gotcha.
And it seemed that their process was just much more complicated than it needed to be.
Okay.
Okay.
All right, well, thanks for clarifying. So forgive me for not understanding, but what kind of sign is this going to be? It's gonna be on the exterior of the building.
Well, they're gonna make some recommendations, probably have one or two monumental signs, and possibly some signage on the building.
Okay, monumental meaning freestanding, is that what that means?
Right.
Okay, so because we're on the corner, we'll have a few, depending on.
One, maybe two.
Okay, all right, I have no idea, okay. Sounds good.
Okay, so then this would be the prices with the signs too, right?
This is just the signs.
So this is kind of like the architect's drawing.
Right.
Okay.
Engineering and things like that.
Right, okay. Okay, so this is there, so the sign is above and beyond. Okay, good.
So it's $5,500 to design the sign?
Correct.
And then what other fees or costs are involved?
We'll go from there.
Legal services.
They will probably give us an estimate of what it costs to.
Fabricate.
To actually fabricate the signs that they're recommending. And I imagine they'll give us some, I would hope they would give us some choices, you know, two signs, three signs, or these materials, and it would cost you this much to make the signs out of this, or, you know. If you got two signs, it would cost this much, or if you got three, it would cost another.
Just as they did with the village.
And that would be part of, all part of their planning, all those different designs and materials and thoughts and.
Right.
Okay.
So are we thinking $20,000, $50,000?
If I had a crystal ball, I could tell you, but
I don't know.
We have no idea.
No.
Okay. But they'll come up with all those prices once they design it.
Do you have it?
I mean, just like when you get an architect doing your house, they'll give you three or four options, say you want to spend this much for this, or you want to spend this much for that, and they'll give you multiple designs.
Did they give you an idea about when they're gonna have this information for us?
Well, yes, Susan said that they'll let us know that as soon as we tell them, give them the go ahead.
Okay.
Which we can do
so
now.
Like it would be,
tonight, they can.
So they would let us know by next meeting or the meeting after.
Yeah, I really don't know what the time frame would be because they are referring to building the materials and they can work with them.
So it might take a while.
Well, you know, Lakota Product Architecture is really familiar with their buildings since they did the design and the renovations, so they're already a step ahead and they've already done some preliminary work, really, so at no cost to us, so they're really ahead.
Okay.
And it's not that big of a deal.
I didn't think so, but I thought it has.
All right, can you take a roll, Diane, please?
Rob?
Yes.
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
No.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes. Okay, next item on the agenda.
Is it this one?
It is to approve the expenditure not to exceed $7,747.68 from the Special Reserve Fund to upgrade the Library District's wireless access points to provide more robust and reliable wireless connections for patrons and staff. Motion? Karen?
Approve this upgrade.
Have a second?
I'll second.
Okay.
So we're only paying about $7,700 out of the total $3,800 cost, right?
Right.
$38,000.
I'm sorry, that's what I meant. I knew that. $38,000.
Yeah.
And that, is it?
It's through the government's E-rate program.
Is it federal? Or it's federal funding?
Yeah. So it's the federal E-rate program, which provides for 80% funding for projects like this. So this is basically replacing not only the access points themselves, which are about $12,000 or so in total cost, but also replacing the switches and some of the infrastructure behind the scenes so that we get a better product. Currently, our current system, I believe, is approximately 6 years old. You know, so it's about time that we replace it. And so we're actually getting $38,000 of value for only paying...
Just under eight.
Yeah,
which is a very good deal.
Yeah, and to let you know what else is coming, we're also getting reimbursements on our voice, so telephone, to the tune of $4,400, and our web access to the tune of $11,000. Those are annual figures that we'll get after the close of the year under the same type of program. So voice gets reimbursed at 40%. The web gets reimbursed at 80% for a total of $15,000, which will reduce our cost structure.
That's
fantastic.
I have to go.
My question,
does anybody else have questions before I ask my question?
I have a question.
Go ahead. Oh, my question is, do we have to come up with the $38,000 and then we get reimbursed?
No.
So we just pay our $7,000 and then we bill, or CDW bills them?
What's happening is that there's a bidding process. The winner of the bid knows that they have to get this money from the E-rate program.
Oh.
So they'll... You know,
so they bill us our portion, and yeah, they know that the other part is coming from...
That was my question as to how are these vendors selected, CDW and CDI? You said it's a bidding process,
right,
but that wasn't
No, it was E-rate's bidding process. So
so the federal government conducts the bidding process?
Yeah, Rich Wasnichka has done a lot of work on this to, you know, continually... provide, you know, different vendors and different, and really, you know, you need to once you identify a project, you have to send this out to a number of different locuses to actually get the information, and then, you know, obviously the lowest price points.
Any other questions? Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay,
Mike.
Diane, please take a roll.
And was Rob?
Yes.
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Okay. And the next item on the agenda is a discussion of our IMRF liability status.
So this is a short presentation just to raise everybody's awareness of our IMRF liability. You know, to remind us, we joined IMRF effective August 1st, and at that point in time, IMRF granted all employees 20% of their past service on a non-contributory basis, which means that employees automatically get service credits for time that they've spent at the library, and it's 20%. And what that means is that we actually have, on day one, an unfunded liability of $858,000, almost $900,000. On top of that, each participant has the option to buy their past service up to the remaining 80%. They can buy part of it, they can buy all of it, they can't buy more than the 80% because they just haven't worked that time. What that does is that creates a situation where the unfunded liability could increase to $3.6 million. Now, it's important to note because the library hasn't been in the program for that long, we haven't really built up a reserve to offset these amounts. So, if you disregard any payments between now and the end of the current fiscal year, If you wrote our financial statements, it would show that we're pretty close to zero funded, and our unfunded liability is somewhere between $900,000 and $3.6 million. Okay. The truth of the matter is, it seems unlikely that all participants will buy all of their past service, but we know that some people will. So it's, you know, the truth is somewhere between those two numbers. Maybe it's, you know, maybe it's $2 million total. I don't know. We'll have to see. So in terms of implications for our financial statements, if NPLD does nothing except make payments at 8.12%, which is our current contribution rate, there'll still be a large unfunded liability to report at the end of the year. 8.12% is going to be close to $225,000 or so, which not all of that goes into our reserve accounts. Plus, there's, you know, we have to consider that the unfunded liability is amortized over 30 years, with, including an interest rate of 7.5%. So, you know, it's just like a mortgage. You have an unpaid balance, which will accrue interest and will be paid over the course of 30 years. It's actually 28 years. Okay. And if there's significant growth in the unfunded liability, the interest charges will grow, of course, in dollars. So many more dollars at $3.6 million than at $900,000. Okay. And that'll impact our contribution rate. So the question I want to put on the table is, what if the library made a lump sum payment to IMRF in addition to what we're currently paying on, through our contribution rate at approximately $19,000 a month? Currently, we have investments earning approximately 1.6% or less. 1.6% is if something is invested for 5 years in a CD. Some of our money is invested at lower rates because we try to keep things continually renewing to try to take advantage of the rates as they increase and to have cash available. The unfunded liability, as I said earlier, will cost 7.5% in interest each year on the outstanding balance. The library will be losing 5.9% on its investments when combined with the cost of the unfunded liability. Okay. And that 5.9% differential is the difference between 7.5% of cost and 1.6% of income. So, whenever you have a situation where you have assets that are returning a low amount, a low return, and you have debt that is incurring a high rate of cost in terms of interest, it makes sense to swap the investment for the debt and essentially make 5.9% on the debt.
What a great idea. Give the man a raise.
So I want to point out that, you know, that this is the same logic. In very similar circumstances to when the library retired its bonds early in 2012. Mm-hmm. Okay, the idea was we had the cash wasn't earning a lot. We had the bonds, we were paying more than the cash was earning from the bonds, so you should pay off the bonds.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Makes sense.
So, implications for the financial statements if we do make a contribution like that. You can make a significant payment which, for all intents and purposes, would eliminate the unfunded liability. Okay. I'm not sure I would recommend it if it was $3.6 million, but if it's around $2 million, I think we could make that work. The financial statements would reflect, as a result, a much higher percentage of funding, which may be 100% funded, depending on the status of debt service purchases. And as a result, our contribution rate would stay pretty low. It would likely, very likely, be lower than the 8.12% and possibly as low as 6.1% on eligible wages.
So it, that would last us for that 6.1 for how long? What would that be?
You have to consider, there's a number of factors that go into a rate. One is changing demographics, who's in the plan, who we're adding to the plan, who's retiring, and things of that nature. Another large factor is how well did IMRF do in the market?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, they did poorly in 2015.
Mm-hmm.
They're doing better this year, but I'm not sure they're going to hit their market at 7.5%. Yeah, I mean, we have to see what the last quarter brings.
Yeah.
But if you remember, I believe it was since 1982, they have averaged a return year over year of 9.94%.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so obviously they had some very big years, they had some mediocre years.
Mm-hmm.
I think there was just a handful of times, maybe 5 or 6 years, where they actually had
a loss.
Yeah. I think there were 11 times in that time period where they actually earned less than 7.5%. You know, so, you know, if the earnings stay up, if the population of employees that are in the plan is stable, and there's not a lot of in and out, a lot of retirements, you know, 6.1%
might be for a while.
Could be realistic for a while. Okay.
And it's a heck of a lot better than 8-something.
Yeah. Yeah, so if you think about it in terms of money, 8.12% is equal to about $19,000. If you take it down to 6.1%, you're basically taking a quarter of that off. So let's say you're taking $5,000 off and put it around $14,000 to $15,000 a month.
Well, and that's in contrast to what it would have gone up to if we didn't do this.
That's yes. Exactly.
And much higher number. They had estimated that in the original letter.
Even though it might give a chunk of money, actually, we in the long run be actually giving less because some of that we could have say it would be interest that we'd give them. So even though we're giving this chunk, really, we could take off.
Yeah, we were avoiding the interest.
Which is,
I mean, think about it. Yeah. Think about it like you're prepaying your mortgage.
Exactly.
So, additionally, when IMRF earns more than its 7.5% target, we get a greater allocation of that earnings, you know, which goes into our reserve, which defrays costs down the road. Any that's it.
So,
I have a question. When will we know how many employees choose to buy back? Would they have deadline for everything to do that?
No. There's several deadlines involved. Right now, and then the same number, that number plus 7.5% for the second policy year.
Okay.
The idea is that, it increases at 7.5% year over year. They could buy it at any time. They could buy it the day before they decide to retire, or the day before they actually retire.
But up to 2 years maximum?
No.
Oh, they can keep going, but every year it would be another 7.5%.
That's right. Their cost gets higher.
More, the longer they wait, the more they get.
Right, okay.
So likelihood at the end is.
Yeah, realistically, if they want to do it, what we're doing
right now is meeting with each and every employee in the plan that has these documents and going through their options and how it will operate.
Okay.
We have a number of employees who have already submitted their paperwork to go ahead and buy. This past service. From that, we could probably make a pretty reasonable estimate of what our liability is going to be at the end of the year, at the end of this year, so that we can, we can size the payment appropriately and send it to them.
So
that's what the book wants to do.
Is the next month too early to put this on the table for a vote?
Well, I think next month is probably the time that you're going to want to vote on it because In order for this to count fully, what we need to do is have it in before the end of the year. So if it's approved at the November meeting, and I, you know, I need a lot more information, you know, so I have 30 days more information to present in terms of sizing the contribution. If we wanted to count, we get, and believe me, their mechanisms are a little bit slow. We want to make sure that it's in their hands well enough in advance so that it actually gets counted into our account.
Why don't we go ahead and put it on the agenda for next week?
Yeah. And then it would, so you're saying, so then it actually goes and counts towards our contribution rate so that it can possibly lower, not necessarily for next year, but the year after.
No, next year we're already locked in.
Because we're already locked in for those 2 years.
Yeah, we're locked in for 8.13%.
Right, right. But it's that when they really reevaluate our.
It might actually drop versus go.
That's going to actually change because of all the people that bought it and said, okay, I've got it.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Regarding investments, about switching, moving around investments to be able to afford this contribution or this amount, how much do we have? Did you say we comfortably could go up to 2 million?
So in total, if you look at the balance sheet from this period.
Mm-hmm. So you're talking like
eight. And if you look at total cash and investments, upper right-hand corner,
mm-hmm.
there's $11,144,000 in our accounts.
Okay.
Now, approximately $1.6 million of that is in the special reserve fund. So that's beyond reach. That's for designated for, you know, special types of purposes. $367,000 additional is in our locked up in the special revenue funds. Okay. So let's call it, for sake of discussion, let's call it $2 million. That leaves about $9 million. We have to live through the next 4 months. So October, November, December, and January, and we spend about $500,000 or so per month for payroll and bills. Okay, you just saw that because we approved the payroll and the bills. That's another $2 million.
Mm-hmm.
So that brings us down to about $7 million that would be available. The $7 million is invested, but it's always coming due. I just had several instruments that were called.
Mm-hmm.
So they had longer maturities, and they decided they want to retire them early, you know, which is a risk that we take when we invest in some of these things. And they're typically government agency bonds, like the Federal Home Loan Bank and things of that nature. There are some CDs as well. So what that tells me, if they're calling things, they expect interest rates to drop.
Mm-hmm.
Because if the interest rates drop, it makes sense for them to call it and reissue and lower their overall interest cost. Okay? But that lowers our return. Okay?
So we might get the most bang for the buck.
And that creates this type of opportunity.
Mm-hmm. Gotcha. So a $2 million investment would cover the $900,000 unfunded, which is what we had as a day one.
Right.
Where do we stand with the people who have already submitted their documents for whatever type of buybacks?
That information is very fluid right now. I am aware of a number of employees who have actually gone out and said, I want to buy it,
mm-hmm.
okay, and have either completed the transaction and they've already funded their decision through means outside of ICMA, or have petitioned ICMA to release the funds to be able to pay for it. So, you know, as I said, that's very fluid. We were talking about it today. Kate Setchell, our IMR representative, has only met with, I'd say, less than a third of our employees, so there's about 2/3 to go, and those decisions there.
Okay.
that could be made.
Greg said that as of next month, he'll have a better idea.
Yeah, we'll have 30 days.
But he still won't have all, but he'll have at least a good idea.
Do you think 2 million would cover that?
You know,
I don't know how many years we're talking about these employees.
Some of them are relatively shallow, you know, 2 or 3 years, and then some of them might, you know, be on a 20-year level. Some of them might be at 20 years, but only by 10.
Okay.
This, you said we're locked in now for 2 years.
Yeah.
So this will actually only will benefit us in 3 years. So say, for example, if we vote for the 2 million to go before the end of the year, next year, if we decide, oh, hey, it really was more than we anticipated, we could always put a little more next year, right?
Yeah. But see, the interesting thing is that for, let's say we hit it right up ahead.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? At 8.12%, 1.78% of that 8.12% is going against the opening unfunded liability.
Mm-hmm.
So that, you know, that would continue to run,
mm-hmm.
until they change the rate. So, you know, we have a lot of cushion.
Yeah, but
that's what I'm saying. We still have, if we see we could have put more, we still have a little time we can play.
And quite frankly, Patty, I'm not sure that everybody is going to act, you know, because it's like, you know, it's a great deal to do it today, but if you don't have it, you don't have it.
Exactly.
Okay, maybe you want to get an equity line to do it, or mortgage your house to do it, which, you know, maybe the right thing to do.
Maybe not.
But those are all decisions that they
have. Okay, well, that'd be great for that other information for next
month. So thank you, Greg.
So
thank you.
We're going to have that on the agenda then for next month.
Nice. Okay, cool. And then the last item under the new business is to determine the 2016-17 levy. Greg?
Okay, so this is just a brief presentation on determining our tax levy. To refresh memories, the 2015 tax levy, which is what we let the board approved in November last year, was collected during calendar 2016. The first installment was collected during the last half of the 15-16 fiscal year, and we just finished collecting the second installment. Okay, and right now we're in 16-17. And the collections are net of all the reductions, so, you know, when we've had settlements with property owners like Best Buy and Coca-Cola and those kinds of places, we don't write a check. They take a credit against their next taxes, and then that flows through, you know, to us in a proportionate share. The final 2015 tax levy was 6.7 million, and the aggregate extension is 6.9 million. Excuse me. If you remember, the aggregate extension includes an estimate of loss percentages, about 3%, which is actually added to the overall percentage, and it's intended to account for things like Coca-Cola and Best Buy, and then people that residents who take, you know, who apply for a reduction in their assessed valuation for their personal homes and things of that nature.
And people who just don't pay their taxes.
And people who don't pay their taxes. But then we get tax sales.
Right? I never thought of that.
So the 2016-17 budget year was constructed using the final 2015 tax levy of 6.7 million for the entire year. I actually used, for budgeting purposes, 6.8 million, just because it was somewhere, you know, it was reasonably between the aggregate extension and the net extension. And, you know, it's not for purposes of analysis only. And it's actually the board's decision to set the 2016 property tax levy, which will be collected next year in 2017. So considerations for the 2016 tax levy are compounded annual growth rate in expenditures over the last five budget years continues to be 2.7%. The major drive on that number is the 3% salary program that we have each year. And salary generally drives about 70 to 75% of our total cost structure. We need to begin funding special revenue funds as they run out of money. You saw just a moment ago on the balance sheet, we're down to about $367,000. We still don't know what the new TIF district is going to do to our collections. Any increases in taxes in that district goes directly to the district itself as opposed to coming to us. But we do get a baseline, and I believe the baseline was 2014, if I'm not mistaken. And also, another consideration is growth and expansion in current services and strategic planning, which we just kicked off in earnest. General fund projection for this analysis, revenue in the general fund is considered consistent from year to year with no increases. So we're expecting everything to be the same, but expenditures were grown by the compounded annual growth rate of 2.7%. And this is just what we're looking at in terms of the general fund revenue and the general fund expenditure lines. So in 15-16, we expect to see a surplus in the general fund of $859,000. Then it increases in the short term to $1.5 million, and that's as a result of the tax increase from last year. And then, as you see, it decreases over time, and that's principally due to the fact that the general fund revenue is constant and at the same rate, and the general fund expenditures are growing at 2.7% per year. So this is, you know, just a picture of, you know, what we look like currently without making any changes to the tax levy going out. If we look at special revenue funds, all the funds except for liability insurance run out of money this fiscal year. Liability insurance fund runs out of money in 21-22. Therefore, we're adding it back, you know, as part of this analysis because it's pretty much self-funded out to that planning horizon. Total annual deficit in 16-17 is expected to be about $267,000, and it grows to $305,000 in 21-22, and that's what those numbers look like. Okay. Just because we're running a deficit doesn't mean that we're going to continue to run a deficit as much as it's an expression of the need. So in order to get through 16-17, we need $267,000 to flow into those accounts in addition to what we're already showing on the tax levy. Here's some data on the Village of Niles TIF. Comprises $80 million of library equalized assessed valuation. The total of that is $1.4 billion. So the district itself comprises 5.7% of our total equalized assessed valuation. I'll try to talk faster.
I'm sorry.
If all property taxes increase at the same rate, we would be okay. But the nature of a TIF district is to make major investment to have that rise faster than the other property. So it would be, you know, it would be a mechanism to fund the improvements in the district itself to make it more attractive for developers to develop. So if the TIF values increase and all other values stay constant, it might cost the library up to $367,000 in lost tax revenue. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, the TIF will be around for 23 years. That's how long it lasts. In terms of our strategic planning, we've started the planning cycle. Currently, we're providing data sets to consultants and setting up focus groups and surveys. We talked a little bit about that earlier tonight. We expect the final plan to be ready in February 2017, and that'll be in time to inform the 2017-2018 budget cycle. And really, it'll also inform our planning through 2022. We have our major initiatives in there that we have to provide down the road. Once we've feathered that into our various budgets and our projections, it'll help to determine future levies. So, summary of considerations, we have general fund surplus of $800,000, which will grow in the short term and then decrease. Special revenue funds will need annual funding of $300,000 or so annually. TIF will reduce tax revenue, but we don't know by how much and how fast when the improvements start. And the strategic planning exercise that we're doing may result in higher costs and or lower tax levies in the future. Limitations on the 2016 tax levy. Increases to the tax levy, the aggregate extension in other words, are limited to the 5% or the increase in the consumer price index. And actually, the state of Illinois tells you what the CPI for the year is. And it's whichever is less. So the CPI increase for 2016 is 0.7%. Therefore, the 2016 aggregate extension would generally be limited to just short of $7 million, $6,969,099, which is this year times 1.007, or an increase of approximately $48,000. So, in terms of what your possible choices are for the 2016 levy, you could reduce it. You can have exactly the same levy from last year, just repeat it, or you could take a slight increase limited by the 0.7% CPI. In terms of deficits, a reduction, depending on the size of the reduction, might put deficits, well within our planning horizon. But the zero change and the slight increase would keep our deficits out of our planning horizon, well past 2022, based on everything that we know now. So future considerations here, a reduction may limit strategic choices. The other two cases would give us a freedom to consider more strategic choices than if we reduce it.
Okay.
And
so let's go here.
That's it.
0.7,
is it? Yes. The total aggregate.
The total aggregate, including both our special revenue funds and the general fund,
yes,
are limited to that amount?
Yes.
So we can only raise even our special revenue funds by $48,000?
Yeah, the whole thing altogether, right. You can only raise. That's why when I showed them on slide.
I can't remember what it says.
Okay, right here. So it says our aggregate extension would generally be limited to 6.969 overall, which is last year's times 1.007.
Go ahead. Recalling the very detailed presentation that Greg did some months ago with the projections for deficits down the road, in future years, I would suggest that we go with the 0.7%, which is the maximum allowable, to avoid the deficits in future years, which is coming down the pike, unless we do something now.
Well, since then we did raise, since that one presentation, we raised the levy, so we're back in the, is it black or red? Black.
Are we? So, Greg, do you have a recommendation?
Well,
so.
I hesitate to do that, but if you look here at the screen, Barbara, this is the general fund projection, so you could see, deficits aren't within our planning horizon, and I'm defining the planning horizon as 2022 at this point. And when you consider that of those numbers, those bottom line numbers, we need to fund special revenue to the tune of about $300,000 a year. Even subtracting $300,000 from those numbers, leaves them pretty healthy.
Still healthy. So maybe, because we did raise, we're in a good position. Maybe if we just keep it at status quo and just keep it the same as we have it, it's surplus up. We're in a good spot. So I'm thinking, and I'll just kind of jump, I'm just thinking, I don't think we need to raise it or lower it. I think if we just stay right where we're at, we can still look at the strategic plan, kind of see where it takes us, and then maybe next year see then if we can lower it or higher it based on
whatever
the strategic plan kind of poses. Mm-hmm. Once we grab those surveys and find out exactly what the community wants and needs. But based on the numbers that I'm seeing, I think what was just reflected by Greg's position, I don't really think we need to raise it. But I would hesitate to lower it because then it does limit our strategic planning possibilities.
So what would the number be, the percent be? What would the levy be?
Be the same as last year.
The same as last year.
Okay.
No raising, no lowering, just keep it.
Okay, so in terms of, I think you're asking about the tax rate.
Uh-huh.
This year the tax rate was 0.512%. And the missing part that we have for the tax rate is what our equalized assessed valuation is for the entire, for the entire district. It's about 1.4 billion.
Mm-hmm.
And if that goes up, that 0.512% will go down, because if the numerator goes up in a fraction, right, the percentage goes down.
Uh-huh.
And if the opposite happens, the percentage will go up. I mean, we had a situation a couple of years ago where we lowered our tax levy, but the rate actually went up because the equalized assessed valuation of all the property in the county went lower than the amount on a percentage basis that we lowered our levy. So I have no way of answering that. I don't know what's going to happen.
Go ahead.
I just have a question. You mentioned on one of these slides that we would need $267,000 to flow into these accounts. You were showing how we were going to be short. What accounts were those? It was a slide.
All the special revenue funds.
Okay.
So, it's the audit, the liability insurance, Social Security.
Okay, I didn't realize that. Okay, got it. All right.
The funds that cannot be, there's no gray area.
You
have to
get
that.
Thank you. Now, let me just complete the thought. Several years ago, when I started, the total fund balance on all of those funds was well over $1 million. So what we've done deliberately is we've worked them down so that they would be closer to zero, and then we'll just tax as we go instead of having another big chunk of funds that we can't spend.
You can't touch. Sure.
Yeah. So we've been very successful in that. And again, the biggest piece of that $367,000 that's already locked up here,
mm-hmm.
is over $200,000 in our liability insurance.
Oh.
Go figure that out.
Yeah, I
got you. It makes no sense.
All right. Well,
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
So if we don't, we're going to have to transfer some funds from our general funds into our special revenue funds, because even if we did increase the levy the maximum amount that we could, $40,000, that's not going to cover what we need in the special revenue fund, right?
Yeah, so what I would do is take the 6.9 6, $6,920,000, which is what our money was last year. And I would reallocate it to make sure that we don't have deficits in special revenue. So that would take a little, rather than transfer, actually doing a transfer out of the general fund, what I would do is, you know, change the revenue line by changing the levy and try to.
That would change the numbers on your, I think it's your next slide, isn't it? The one that shows what our.
This one?
Yes.
Yes, that would.
That's assuming that all those dollars are going to jump to revenue fund, which you're suggesting now is what we actually would need to do, and then we take some of those dollars and put it in special revenue.
Right, and then, but then Greg, I'm sorry, then Greg was saying even though the lowest would be at the right for 2021 would still only be like 400. We would still have a little cushion there of money.
Right.
It's not a ton of money, but it's still, we're still in the.
In the black.
Black.
Red means you're bleeding, we're not.
I don't know. Yeah, I'm bad with the red black, I'm bad with the black, and I'm bad with that. Okay. Is there any more to go ahead?
No, I was just, thanks for my opinion there. I would actually like to see us capture that a little additional amount of money. It's not very much, $48,000. And we're very, very strictly limited by tax caps in terms of the amount we can capture. If we don't capture it this year, we won't get it. Again, it doesn't make a big difference, $48,000 or not $48,000, but I'd like to capture that little extra income and put it into our special revenue fund. So that's my opinion.
I would just keep it the same. I think you don't want to lower it. It's not, nobody remembers when you lower something, they always remember when you raise it. If it holds out through the future, then that's fine. It's not really that much to, I don't know if the adding that to raise for what little amount of money that is, if it's worth.
With the publicity?
Yes.
Sure.
Is what you're saying?
Yes. Yeah. Especially after last year? Yes. I agree.
And then next year it would be the same thing. We look at the CPI and then it's based on.
I think if you look at the CPI, you have to look at what the strategic plan says and how that would impact it.
I'm good. I just need to run to the bathroom.
Okay, go ahead.
Are we adding on this or what?
Well, yeah, we're going to have to vote, but go ahead, let her go.
We're in the air discussion. Should we wait until she comes back?
It's okay, go ahead.
Greg, I'm glad that we bit the bullet last time and took your advice, and now we're in the
bathroom. Well, that wasn't my advice. It was.
Well, the thing is, it was your presentation convinced us that we're, you know, in trouble if we didn't do something.
And last time we had the ability to raise it as much as we were able to.
Right.
We're
it saved us.
Waiting until now, we would have been up a creek. The problem is, with all the flack we took last, with all those meetings, with the guy with the candy he put on the pedestal and stuff, I really don't think that's going to crack real soon. You know, and I'm concerned that if we raise it, but yet it shows we don't really have to, we're going to have them with the candy, and enough candy. That's a story you weren't here for.
okay, so Karen, Linda, what's your I'm fine with keeping it flat for this year. Just for the reason of seeing the projections for at least till 2016-17, 2017-18, we're still good. Next year, if we feel once we have a strategic plan in place, and then we can see what our CPI is, and we can raise it if it's still the 48,000, I mean, it's never nothing, right? We can never, it could be nothing.
I mean, frankly, you could have years where the CPI,
because that's what happened like in 2010 when there was like